Welcome to BRI International Yeshiva Internet Lectures. Rebbe Les Gosling will be teaching from many subjects on the biblical revelation and the first century Jewish thought form.
This is Lecture 10, Daniel of Babylon, Prince, Prophet, Statesman, the Great Visionary of Prophecy. I've entitled this lecture, Daniel, What the Rabbis Don't Tell You. Many years ago, I felt the sting of rejection from the synagogue. A close friend of mine had been studying the scriptures relating to the end of the world and had directed some discreet inquiries to the rabbi. The learned rabbi had countered with an immediate retaliation from the Talmud. Quote, cursed are the bones of him who calculates the time of the end. Unquote. That was the conclusion of the conversation, and my friend was ever after held in a measure of suspicion. When my mate relayed what had occurred at the office of the rabbi, I saw it as a challenge to find out why Jews were forbidden to make attempted calculations, especially as they related to the prophecies of Daniel. To my mind, it didn't make much sense that God would leave his servant Daniel with all sorts of prophetic indicators that marked the end of time, including actual numerical factors that would be presumably easily enough worked out and then not be allowed to access and calculate that same information. So, putting pen to paper, I spent a considerable time studying the prophecy of Daniel as it related to the coming of the Messiah. I was astonished at what I discovered. The Messiah had already come, and his name was Yeshua. You see, there is a timetable. That timetable was irrevocably in place. The Messiah had to arrive within the exact time frame given in Daniel's prophecy. Any other pretender to the office of Mashiach would either need to arrive at that precise moment in history or be proved false, a complete imposter, an unqualified charlatan, a consummate fraud. It was that simple. It was also just that important. So I made an appointment to speak with the rabbi. Now, he had been forewarned and forearmed by my friend, who wanted to remain in favor with his own friends and relatives in the synagogue. I had a speech prepared. After a cordial invite to come into the office and sit down, I got as far as, "Dear Rabbi, I've been studying Daniel's prophecies about the coming of the Mashiach, and then he cut me off in mid-sentence and repeated the Talmudic addiction, which he had already delivered to my friend. Cursed are the bones of him who calculates the time of the end. Then his eyes narrowed and his frown cut deep into his already wrinkled forehead. And he said, is this about Jesus? Well, I took a deep breath and replied with a rabbinic argumentative edge, I do not think it reasonable that any of us should hide behind ancient rabbinical utterances which no longer permit us the privilege to think. Thinking is what makes us human beings unique above the animal kingdom, for we are all made in the image of Hashem. And what did the rabbi do? Was he impressed by my ability to put forth a formidable case filled with subtle implications? Not at all. He forthrightly forbade me to play around with Daniel's prophetic calculations. If I did not respect his wishes in this matter, I would be forthrightly turfed out. The rest is history. Years later, I discovered the same formula used by my rabbi, utilized to enormous advantage in certain Christian ministries. Fear, superstition, and ignorance rules wherever religious men gather together. Make no mistake, the Talmud, the collected sayings of mere mortals, is vaunted to be in many ways above the revealed will of Almighty God. Its voice of rabbinic authority takes a major precedence over the Torah of Moses, the most holy division of the Hebrew Scriptures. It is written, my son, be more careful in the observance of the words of the scribe than in the words of the Torah. Well, that's brazen, but it's entirely true. Rav Shmuel ben Nachmani had said in the name of Rav Yonathan, may the spirit of those who calculate the end fire. For they say, since the predetermined time has arrived, and he has yet to come, he will never come. And again, whoever forecasts the date of Mashiach's arrival has no place in the world to come. What did Daniel write that has caused such fear, trepidation, and terror, and for that matter, other hostile reactions amongst rabbis and their Talmudic students? Consider. If you look at Daniel chapter 9, verses 24 to 27, we read this. 70 weeks have been decreed for your people and your holy city, until the measure of transgression is filled and that of sin is complete, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in eternal righteousness and prophetic vision ratified, and to anoint the most holy of holies. You must know and understand that from the going forth of the word to restore and to rebuild Jerusalem until the Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall, even in times of distress. And after those 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. Now the alternative Hebrew rendering is the Messiah will disappear and vanish. And the army of a leader that shall come will destroy the city and the sanctuary, and its end will come through a flood. And until the end of the war, desolation is decreed. And he shall make, or confirm, a firm covenant with many during 1 week. And in the middle of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and the meal offering to cease. At the corner, that means at the corner of the altar, will be an appalling abomination, or an overspreading abomination, until the decreed destruction will be poured down upon the appalling thing. Now that's what Daniel wrote, and this is the closest possible rendering of the Hebrew text in question. We shall examine this prophecy in a moment, but first let me state categorically that many Jews are ignorant of the fact that despite the edict against calculating the Danielic end time, some prominent rabbis actually made some valiant attempts at arriving at a conclusive date for the coming of the Messiah. How did they justify their actions? That was quite simple. They just interpreted the edict differently. And who could argue with their ingenuity? A Barbanel, 15th century Spain, said it was quite permissible to calculate the intended arrival date of the Messiah as long as the calculations weren't based on astrology. Nachmanides, Ramban, 13th century, claimed the prohibition only applied to generations that lived in centuries past, and that because he considered the redemptive eve of the final generation was fast approaching, there was no longer any need to further refusal to make calculations regarding Daniel. But Judaism continues to deny that Yeshua the Nazarene fulfilled the 300-plus prophecies as identifying signs of the Messiah. Judaism continues to be extremely volatile when it comes to any Jew converting to Yeshua. It seems you can be a devotee of Krishna, or follow the teachings of the Buddha, or even be an outright atheist like the excommunicated Henry Kissinger, and be still listed in volumes written by Jews and also appear on internet sites as being decidedly Jewish. Indeed, you can even be a murderous gangster of the style of Louis Lepke Buchholter and Meyer Lansky, and still be awarded as being Jewish. But if you are a Jew and you believe that Yeshua the Nazarene is the Messiah, you will no longer exist as a Jew. It will be as though you never existed at all. Small wonder there are a number of closet believers among the rabbis. They have seen with their own eyes what happens to their colleagues who claim Yeshua. They lose everything, including their very identity. Moses Maimonides recognized that the major reason Jews were rejecting Yeshua was because he taught that the Torah is now abolished. There was no way in the mind of this great Middle Ages Jewish sage and codifier that Jesus could be the Messiah. Writing in 12th century Egypt, Maimonides summed up his teaching about Jesus. Jesus of Nazareth, he proclaims in his letter to Yemen, impelled people to believe that he was a prophet sent by God to clarify perplexities in the Torah, and that he was the Messiah that was predicted by each and every seer. He interpreted the Torah and its precepts in such a fashion as to lead, he says, to their total annulment, to the abolition of all its commandments, and to the violation of its prohibitions. The sages of blessed memory, having become aware of his plans, before his reputation spread among our people, meted out fitting punishment to him. And that's what he wrote. Now he also wrote this: as for Yeshua of Nazareth, who claimed to be the anointed one and was killed by the court, that's the Jewish court, Daniel had already prophesied about him thus, quote, "And the children of your people's rebels shall raise themselves to set up prophecy and will stumble." Can there be a bigger stumbling block than this? He asked. Then he adds, "All the prophets said that the Anointed One saves Israel and rescues them, gathers their strayed ones, and strengthens the mitzvah, whereas this one caused the loss of Israel by sword, and to scatter their remnant, and humiliate them, and to change the Torah, and to cause most of the world to erroneously worship a god besides the Lord. But the human mind has no power to reach the thoughts of the Creator, for his thoughts and ways are unlike ours." All these matters of Yeshua of Nazareth and of the Ishmaelite who stood up after him, now he's referring here to Muhammad, are only intended to pave the way for the anointed king and to mend the entire world to worship God together thus, "For then I shall turn a clear tongue to the nations to call all in the name of the Lord and to worship him with one shoulder." How is this? He writes, "The entire world has become filled with the issues of the Anointed One and of the Torah and the laws, and these issues had spread out unto faraway islands and among many nations uncircumcised in the heart, and they discussed these issues and the Torah's laws. These say, these laws were true but are already defunct in these days and do not rule for the following generation. Whereas the other ones say, there are secret layers in them and they are not to be treated literally, and the Messiah had come and revealed their secret meaning. But when the anointed king will truly rise and succeed and will be raised and uplifted, they all immediately turn about and know that their fathers inherited falsehood and their prophets and ancestors led them astray." Unquote. Maimonides, Judaism's most esteemed halakhic, that's legal, authority, made a monumental error. That error had to do with the fact that he took one look at the religion supposedly founded by Jesus Christ of Nazareth and said, "Well, if that is the religion of the Messiah, he and his church can drop dead." The religion of Jesus, he thought, was the Roman Catholic Church, replete with Mary worship and other degrading pagan beliefs and practices and anti-Torah views of life. Then, of course, there were the Crusades, and I don't mean Billy Graham-style Crusades either. But we know Yeshua did not do away with his father's Torah, nor did he change the customs of the father. The Messiah was expected to make the Torah more binding, and he did so. The Messiah was expected to modify certain regulations and usher in new regulations, and he did so. The Messiah was expected to bring the Gentiles into covenant relationship with Israel's God, and he did so. But this was a Yeshua Maimonides knew nothing about. Holding the memory of the blessed sage in paramount importance and revering everything he wrote as if it were from and by the finger of God himself, all forms of Judaism treasure the opinion of Maimonides and thus reject Yeshua. Even those sectarians who recognize that Yeshua possessed immense power, admits an Orthodox Jew in the classic work of Mintz, quote, "We believe that Jesus was taken away from the Jews." He says, "He was a great power. He could have been a Talmudic scholar or a tzaddik, a righteous Jewish saint. But he was drawn," he writes, "to the other side of the fence." Since the pagan, cross-bearing Roman Catholic Church had rejected God's Torah, braced the sacred Hebrew Scriptures as nothing more than an Old Testament, replacing it with a new, streamlined, salvific edition of Scripture, and claimed in its exalted, bejeweled, tiara-wearing papacy to represent Christ, Maimonides repudiated Yeshua as the Jewish Messiah to come. The miracle is, however, that rabbis are still coming to Yeshua, are still being drawn to the Messiah, and there is absolutely nothing the modern rabbis can do to prevent it. Daniel stated unequivocally, with such clarity as to preclude any misunderstanding, that Messiah would appear here on earth after a period of 69 weeks. When we grasp that there is a prophetic factor to be incorporated into these equations of a day standing for a year in Ezekielian terms, and I would refer you to Ezekiel 4 verse 6, which seems to have Torah approval in Numbers 14 verse 34, we are left with a period of 483 years. That's 69 times 7. And this 483-year period was to be counted as commencing with a decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. When that period would end, Messiah would appear. Well, clear enough, apparently. But really, to be entirely honest, the text is the beginning of troubles, literally. Because, you see, in what year was this command or decree given? How is this to be interpreted? After all, there was a command by Jeremiah in 596 BCE, some say 598, in which he prophesied that Judah would return to Jerusalem. For that reference, have a look at Jeremiah 29, verse 10. There was the command by Cyrus, Koresh, in his first year as king over Babylon in 538 BCE, some say 536, others say 539. In which specific reference is made to Jerusalem being rebuilt. You can find that in 2 Chronicles 36, 22 and 23. And again, look at Isaiah 44, verse 28. Then there was the command given to Nehemiah in the 20th year of the Persian king Artaxerxes, 445-44 BCE, when the king ordered the rebuilding of Jerusalem. You'll find that in Nehemiah, chapter 2, verses 1 through to 8. Then there was the command to rebuild the temple, given in the second year of Darius, 519-518 BCE, to confirm the original decree of Koresh. Have a look at Haggai chapter 1, and look also at Zechariah chapter 1, verses 1 through to 6. There was the command to beautify the temple in the seventh year of Artaxerxes, that's 457 BCE, which can also be construed as having some relevance. You'll find that in Ezra chapter 7, verses 1 through 11. For that matter, Jeremiah also made a second prophecy involving a command to restore the city in 605 BCE. Was it this one? Jeremiah 25, verse 11. Look, some scholars have even found commands in the first year of Darius the Mede in 539, again in the second year of Darius Nothus in 423, the second year of Artaxerxes Longimanus in 462, the 10th year of the reign of Artaxerxes Longimanus, or the earlier date of his second edict on the ground of his co-regency with his father Xerxes in 454, and the second year of the reign of Xerxes in 483. Now, let's be honest, these commands span some 150 years. So which command is intended? Well, trouble is, Daniel didn't say. There is even the possibility that Daniel is referring to a command still future to rebuild Jerusalem to God's specifications at the end of the age. In fact, we find reference in Daniel to a wall being built, even in troublous times. And what's Israel doing at the moment? Building a wall. In fact, the Ottoman Emperor Suleiman the Magnificent uttered a decree to do just such a thing in 1537 of our time period. Not only was Jerusalem to be rebuilt, but also its walls were to be restored. Takes little acumen to appreciate that the full scope of the 70 weeks or 490 years added to this date brings us to 2028, which is the most significant date as far as all BRI students should be by now well aware. But again, Daniel has not made it clear. Now, some of these dates bring us to 27 CE, the date of the mikveh baptism of Yeshua. Another date will bring us to 30, the date of the crucifixion of Yeshua. And other dates will bring us into the era of the fifth procuratorship of Judea, the age in which Yeshua walked the earth. Whatever the case, the dating is fixed and focused by Daniel on the time of Yeshua the Nazarene, no matter how we may wish to hedge an O and R about the issue. The issue, you see, is Yeshua. Make no mistake. The rabbis know this and make Yeshua an issue indeed. Daniel went on to tell us that certain events would correspond to the coming of the Messiah. Number one, the measure of transgression would be filled and the issue of sin is completed. In other words, Messiah would do something to eradicate the record of transgression or sin. The time would come when God would no longer hold sins against men. Transgressions and sins would have reached the place where they would be considered by God as filled, full to the top to be dealt with. There was no doubt in the minds of the original Messianic Jewish and Gentile believers that the time had come in their day when God was no longer counting men's transgressions against them. The record exists from the days of Sheol, the personal emissary of Messiah. Read it in your own first century record in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19 and 20. It says, God was in Messiah, conciliating the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of conciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Messiah, as though God did beseech by us. We pray in Messiah's place, be you conciliated to God. Now Daniel stated that the issue of sin was completed. The idea in Hebrew intends a sealing, a removal from the sight and the view of God. The expression is derived from the practice of sealing up of those things one puts aside for concealment. When Messiah hung lifeless, his nailed body torn to shreds on the bloody tree of Golgotha, Yeshua had become the antitype of the sacrificial offerings of the Jerusalem sanctuary. It was no longer necessary for the sinner to bring to God a sin offering. As John the Baptist said in John 1:29, Behold the Lamb of God, that's the Passover Lamb, who takes away, who bears away, the sin of the world. Daniel confesses to God that the sins of Israel were opened and known by everyone. After all, the Jews were in captivity in Babylon because of those same sins. The pagans knew that God had rejected his people for transgression. In Daniel 9 and verse 16, he says, O Lord, according to all your righteousness, I beseech you, let your anger and your fury be turned away from your city Jerusalem, your holy mountain, because for our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and your people are become a reproach to all that are about us. It's not a matter of how we today may interpret such passages from the first century documents. It's entirely a matter of how the first century Messianic believers, both Jew and Gentile, interpreted such passages. And they had no doubt at all that Yeshua was the Messiah. He came precisely when he was expected to come. Remember, the whole world was waiting his arrival, not just in Judea, but in Tibet, in India, and other places, the Parthian Empire, etc., even in China. Tens of thousands of Jews at that time acknowledged him and accepted him. And further, more Jews over the last 19 years have converted to Mashiach than all the Jews in the past 1900 years. Daniel is telling us that God dealt with sin at the crucifixion of Yeshua. Second point. Daniel said he would make reconciliation for iniquity. Now the Hebrew defines this as a covering or a hiding, kapara. To cover carries the idea of pardon or forgiveness. In other words, the sins of Israel were to be atoned for, covered by God. The Messiah would accomplish this intent. The essential idea of divine security is locked within the concept of kapara, or kapara, atonement, expiation, propitiation. For clarification, consider for a moment Noah's Ark, which gave divine security to all who were found therein. In fact, the divine security was absolute. And this is what is implied by Moses in the statement that the pitch, or the asphalt, was within and without. You'll find that in Genesis 6:14. Asphalt is a spreading covering that seals. Of course, this is a type of our deliverance, our salvation, in Mashiach. We are saved to the uttermost. and secure to the uttermost, both within and without. Salvation is always complete. Rav Scholl was drawing on the topology of Noah's Ark when he noted that the lives of the Gentile believers at Colossae, he wrote, were hid, you see, hid, as Noah and his family were hid in the Ark, hid with Messiah in God, Colossians 3:3. Our being hidden in the Messianic Ark is entirely God's responsibility. Hence, Moses noted that God himself shut Noah in Genesis 7:16, which Peter recognized in his mention that we are kept by the power of God through faith unto deliverance, that's salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time, or as Yeshua would have put it, the days of Noah, 1 Peter 1:5. In brief, kafar is derived from an Arabic root meaning to cover sin. A similar word was used in the ancient Syrian tongue, kuparu, which meant to purge away sin. The Hebrew word kippurim, or the English atonements, stem from this language use. Moses' failure in Genesis 6:14 to use the normal and common word for pitch, zetet, speaks volumes. Kofar is the noun form of kafar. It is really a mistranslation to use the Latinism atonement. When we do this, we bow to Rome's superior interpretive powers of intellect to inform us of what was really intended by Moses in Jewish thought form. You see, nowhere else in Hebrew scripture is kofar rendered pitch. Moses renders the word pitch as kofar here for the first time to reveal that we have shelter from the storm which results from sin. The entire globe was deluged because of man's hostility to Torah, and while the storm fell upon the ark, those who were in that vessel were absolutely safe. The fact is, Yeshua, God in flesh, took the storm of heaven upon himself so we can have an appropriate shelter in that same God. He directed his anger toward himself. This is why the psalmist wrote of Mashiach, predicted sufferings in terms related to the Noachian deluge. In Psalm 42, verse 7, it says, all thy waves and thy billows, you see, drawing an analogy with Noah's deluge, are gone over me. Now, originally, the word kofar in Hebrew meant the price of a life. Significantly, kofar is used in Hebrew scriptures in association with the idea of ransom in Exodus 21:30 and Numbers 35, 31, and 32. Pitch or asphalt as a covering. Also, the henna plant, which is utilized for its dye here in Australia and presumably elsewhere in the civilized world. Henna remains the Jewish brand name of a hair dye. Kafar means to cover, purge, cover over, as with pitch. In strict Hebrew, kofar means to cover or to make covering in a concrete judicial sense and to expiate or make expiation in a figurative judicial sense. Moses uses it in Genesis 6:14 in a concrete non-judicial sense. However, we can draw appropriate illustrations from it, hence his inspired use of a term other than zetet. He's in fact making a point, as we can all see quite plainly. As a covering, kofar, or kofar, protects from the eye. But whose eye? Obviously, the eyes of God, Proverbs 20, verse 8. You see, the covering formed a merciful shield from God's glare, his searching justice, which, I might add, is always rooted in his loving grace. Hence the motive of finding grace in the eyes of God. And Daniel tells us that we are now safe from the glare of the righteous eyes of Hashem. We are safe because we are covered from any evidence of sin. Our transgressions, sins, and iniquities are covered, sealed up. God no longer looks at them. They don't exist. Reconciliation for iniquity occurred in the crucified body of flesh of the Messiah 2,000 years ago. Now there is a third blessing contained in the Danielic prophecy. The third blessing is to bring in eternal righteousness. God's justice prevailed in the work of Yeshua the Messiah. That righteousness or justice would be eternal as to its implications and considerations. It was not to be in any way temporary. When Yeshua came to earth, he did so not just in order to deal with sin as such, that is, to blot it out, but to implement a larger, greater, broader, more superb and grand plan, nothing less than to reconcile man to God. To achieve this, Yeshua had to provide a severe righteousness that would be acceptable to God the Father, and he had to do this on humankind's behalf. He had to thus represent man to God. The messianic teaching located in the messianic scriptures is plain about our irrevocable standing in the sight of God. We are righteous because of what Messiah has accomplished on our behalf. We are not righteous because of anything we can do on our own behalf or on someone else's behalf. I think we all understand that. We are righteous, we are just, only and always because of the integral character of the Messiah, and that character as openly evidenced, exposed, and communicated in the crucifixion. Well, there's a fourth point. Daniel said the Messiah would ratify the prophetic vision. To ratify means to make valid and binding by a formal legal act. If this was not accomplished by the legal crucifixion, what was? You see, God the Father ratified, approved, and confirmed the awesome act of sacrifice concerning which all the prophets looked. In that one act of crucifixion, that legal document, and all that went with it, Messiah legally conciliated God to the entire universe and the universe to God. And BRI's representatives, our Talmudim, are eagerly spreading the word, that is, the gospel, of the prophetic vision of the crucified God-man Yeshua, the architect, the Logos, the Memra of the universe in whom dwells all things. Finally, Daniel said he would anoint the most holy of holies. It's unquestioned that the phrase here refers to the sanctuary, and especially to the chamber where God dwelt between the arch overspreading wings of the cherubim upon the mercy seat, the Ark of the Covenant. After all, this vision under discussion is the vision Daniel received from Gabriel, recorded in Daniel 8 and especially to verses 13, 14, and 26. Still, I'd like my Talmudim to appreciate something else about this prophetic scenario, another point of view which very few believers have ever understood. You see, very few realize what was meant by the record that when Yeshua came to earth as a little baby, Miriam, whom the gospel writer explicitly states had temple connections, wrapped him up in swaddling clothes. All children who have been to Sunday school and participated in Christmas play are aware of the story about the swaddling clothes. But what were the swaddling clothes? The angelic powers that openly displayed their armed might at the birth of the Messiah in Bethlehem told terrified shepherds that they would find the Son of God lying in a manger as a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes. We find the account in Luke chapter 2, verse 12. It was to be a sign to them of the troubling authenticity of the awesome event. But today most of us have lost the significance of it. Listen and let the truth of God really sink in at this juncture. It is most exciting. We should all rejoice about this fact. Swaddling cloth is that remnant of cloth which clothed the high priest and which he wore once a year when he entered into the most sacred portion of the temple of God in Jerusalem, the Holy of Holies. He entered the Holy of Holies only once annually, and that was on Yom Kippurim, the great fast day of the Jewish people, the Day of Atonement. Because he was exposed to the Shekinah of the Lord God in that tight compartment and was exposed to God's radiant light, the linen clothing was considered far too sacred for reuse in common, ordinary, day-to-day usage. So the priest tore this linen cloth into strips of cloth and then used those same bands to light the magnificent menorah on the last festival day of the Jewish calendar as revealed in Leviticus 23. The last great day of the Jewish festival, an agricultural cycle, pictured the entire salvation plan of God in its consummate conclusion, a full, complete, and total salvation of all living creatures, all sparks of light, back into the source of their origin, the true living God. But there was yet another usage for this cloth, and this is wonderful teaching indeed. The strips of holy cloth that had been exposed to the glory and presence of Almighty God, was used to wrap together the scroll of the Torah of God. You see, when there was a new edition of the scroll completed, the old scroll was wrapped in these swaddling bands and symbolically buried, or literally buried, as a matter of fact. So here was Yeshua, the living Torah from eternity, who shared the very glory of God as the mind of God, as the archetypal man, the Adam Kadmon, being wrapped tightly as a baby in bands with the strips of exposed linen cloth worn previously as holy garments by the high priest in the Holy of Holies on the most sacred and holy day of the year. The living Torah was found by the shepherds wrapped in highly appropriate swaddling cloth and lying hidden in a manger. But the incredible story does not end there, not at all. Rather, the word manger in the Greek language is from a root word which has its equivalent in the Hebrew meaning sukkah, tabernacle. Yeshua, the Messiah, came and tabernacled with us, according to the emissary John the priest. In John 1:14, we read, "And the Logos was made flesh and tabernacled among us." The seventh month, Tishri, in which Yeshua was born, is the month which celebrates the festival of tabernacles, sukkah. Once again, the sacred record of the life of Yeshua is revealed to be a tightly woven tapestry, showing the intricate, super technological, creative handiwork of God the Father. God, you see, signs all his work. Yeshua, the anointed one, was destined to die in blood and mucus, as he was anointed at his birth with the blood and mucus of Miriam, his mother. Yeshua began his life as he ended it. That he was the expected anointed one is the way the Gospels continue to portray him. Even in death, Yeshua is anointed by women with ointment. All of this has immense significance. There is no way any of us can read Daniel 9:24-27 and not see Yeshua highlighted throughout the text. Understand this. Daniel states that after the 69 weeks, the anointed one will disappear and vanish. The Jewish teachers, those who were supposed to be in the know about such things, plainly taught that when the Messiah would come, he would conquer the world in a white charger, subjugating the hated Romans, humiliating them and driving them back to Italy and out of the Holy Land. He would then proceed to usher in his kingdom and exalt the Jews as the theocratic nation under God. All of this would occur at the time Messiah was expected, 69 weeks from the going forth of the decree to rebuild Jerusalem. But brethren, God said the opposite. The Messiah, the Anointed One, would simply disappear and vanish. Did Yeshua disappear and vanish? According to the record, he did just that. After a period of ministry that was launched at age 30, Yeshua was crucified by Rome for treason. The disciples claimed he rose from the dead and taught his Talmudim for a period of 40 days. But then a strange, unexpected thing happened. If you turn to Acts 1, verses 9 through 11, we read this. He was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were gazing intently into the sky as he was leaving when suddenly two men dressed in white stood before them. "Men of the Galil," they said, "why do you stand here gazing up into the sky? This same Yeshua, who has been taken from you into the heavens, will return in the same way as you have seen him go into the heavens." Daniel was informed well in advance of this spectacular event, almost 600 years prior to its occurrence. Yeshua the Messiah literally disappeared and vanished before their very eyes. The Greek version translates the text, "And thou shalt know and understand that from the going forth of the command for the answer and for the building of Jerusalem until Christ the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks, and after the 62 weeks the Anointed One shall be destroyed." You see, the Messiah would be destroyed, or cut off, according to the Greek text, and millions of Jews for two millennia have ignored this plain statement of Scripture. The Hebrew version says he will disappear and vanish. The Jewish rabbis and the Jewish people are therefore in a classic 22, catch 22, and God Almighty has put them there. What a wonderful God. The rabbis forbid the Jewish people to calculate the 70 weeks prophecy. Small wonder. Daniel had prophesied, "There shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks, or 483 years to 27 CE, And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not to himself. Yeshua submitted to a mikveh, his baptism, in 27. After that event, Messiah was to be cut off or destroyed. One must confront the question, how long after Messiah was to come was he to be cut off or destroyed? The book of Daniel is ominously silent on the issue. However, Yeshua confronted the Jewish religious leaders with this little gem of wisdom in John 2, verse 19 and verse 21. Destroy, or cut off, this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. But he was speaking of the temple of his body. John recorded this incident faithfully because he knew upon what prophecy Yeshua was basing this premise. Daniel 9:26. Yeshua was in the grave for a period of 3 days. There are those who say that this prophecy is to be understood as referring to 3 prophetic days, that is, a period of 3 years, a day for a year, and they may be right. Certainly, 30 CE can be ascertained from one of the decrees involving Jerusalem. It again would point to the correctness of Daniel's forecast. After all, Yeshua uttered these words recorded by his cousin, the priestly John, at the very start of his ministry. 3 years later, it was 30 CE. Some rabbis today are coming out of the closet regarding the person of Yeshua. One rabbi who wishes to remain nameless said recently, after a number of arguments against the church, and concerning all of which I am in complete agreement with him, quote, but I cannot discount 2,000 years of history and how the world has literally been centered on this man from Galilee. So if I had to make a choice, I would say that he was to be the intended Messiah of Israel, but at that time Israel did not warrant the Messianic kingdom and thus her king. But I don't know for sure. But we need to know these events that shaped and withheld the kingdom of God being materialized on this planet. Time will tell for sure, but an honest evaluation of the facts dictates that dogmatism is not warranted in such a consideration, he said. The jury is still out, but we are all entitled to our faith. For me, I personally pray for the coming of the Messiah and will not be surprised at all that when he arrives, it will be Yeshua of Nazareth. Maimonides emphasized in his classic 13 Principles of Faith, Principle 12, as a matter of fact, I believe with perfect faith in the coming of Messiah, and even though he may tarry, nevertheless, I will wait for him every day that he will come. None of us have much longer to wait. The BRI is in the forefront of restoring the lost Jewish thought form to the biblical revelation, an understanding of which is paramount for the Jewish people to properly recognize and behold the Lord their God. There are those who have claimed Yeshua as their Lord and Savior at this time. There are those who still have to make up their mind. Well, time is fast running out. We can adopt a wait-and-see policy if we wish, but a parable given by Yeshua himself in Matthew 25 cautions against such procrastination. The Lord Yeshua remains the only Messiah ever to come to the Jewish nation at the exact and precise time that Daniel had predicted. To think otherwise is fallacious. The proof that Yeshua is the Messiah is established by the rabbis themselves who forbid the calculation of Daniel 7.